Jesus, if you haven't noticed, he hits a lot of what we call hot topics, areas where it's sort of, in a way, a little scary to tread, but we see that Christ wasn't that scared to confront pride, to talk about things like how today. I sometimes wish I was the topical preacher where I could preach a message today on Thanksgiving and why we should be grateful, but we're going through Mark, and if you're visiting today, it just so happens as we preach through books of the Bible, we have hit the passage now, Jesus teaching about divorce, about marriage, about remarriage. So my aim today, if you're here and you maybe have experienced divorce, you're products of divorce, I'm not here to beat you up. I'm not here to make you feel guilt or shame. It just so happens we're in Mark chapter 10. We kicked this series off back in September 2014, and any preacher wouldn't really go, I think I'm going to preach on divorce today. So don't feel like if you've been through a tough season that we're trying to single that out. I just want to be faithful to Scripture. So we're going to read Mark chapter 10, verses 1 to 16, and hear what Jesus has to say. And it says this, "And they left there, and they went to the region of Judea and beyond the Jordan, and the crowds gathered to him again and again, as was his custom, he taught them. And Pharisees came up, and in order to test him, they asked, 'Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife?' He answered them, 'What did Moses command you?' They said, 'Moses allowed a man to write a certificate of divorce and to send her away.' And Jesus said to them, 'Because of your hardness of heart, he wrote you this commandment. But from the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and his mother and hold fast to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh, so they are no longer two, but one flesh. What therefore God has joined together, let no man separate.' And in the house, the disciples asked him again about this matter, and he said to them, 'Whoever divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery against her. And if she divorces her husband and marries another, she commits adultery.' And they were bringing children to him that he might touch them, and the disciples rebuked them. But when Jesus saw it, he was indignant, and he said to them, 'Let the children come to me. Do not hinder them, for to such belongs the kingdom of God. And truly I say to you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God like a child shall not enter it.' And he took them in his arms, he blessed them, laying his hands on them." Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you again for this time we have to gather and open up the pages of Scripture. And God, the good news today that is in these pages is simply there's life. I pray today that your Spirit would go to places in our hearts and in our lives to once again encourage us, to once again challenge us and convict us, even where we need conviction. So I pray, God, that we would look at your word, knowing that you have good for us. And God, I just thank you so much that you're a good God, that you have a good plan. In your name we pray. Amen. A few weeks ago, I took my wife out on date night. She loves jazz, so the jazz festival was in Charlottetown. So we had dinner. It was amazing. She got crab cakes. I got ribs. It was awesome. And we sat there, and I engaged my wife in conversation over good food. We left the restaurant. We went down to where the jazz festival was happening. We walked in, and lo and behold, Kelsey and myself were the youngest couple there. And everybody was up, and they were dancing in the middle, but all the chairs were taken except for a few chairs in the front row. So I'm not a dancer. I'm your typical white boy. I just don't dance. There's no need for it. Why? When you're as white as me, you just don't do it. So we didn't dance. We went up, and we sat down, but we sat right in front, the only seats left, right in front of the speakers. Now, if you've ever had that experience, like your heart could stop and you just keep living. It's how it goes. The bass just keeps pounding. And then as we're on date night, we like to talk, right? I'm at that point. I've been married 10 years, so I've learned the art of conversation, man. It's actually amazing as you're married and you sit there with your wife. The only problem we were having was the noise. Kelsey, if she speaks, she has a low tone anyways, and I'm just looking at her like, I have no clue what you're saying. So pretty much we were yelling at each other in the front row, and finally I just thought, this is useless. There's no point of yelling, and it was so noisy, and I just stopped because here's the thing. My wife loves jazz, and I remember just looking over at her as the band was playing, as they were singing, and in a way she was captured by it, but I was captured by my wife. It was sort of this experience where it was noisy, but everything sort of became dim. This is like romantic movie time, right? And I looked over at my wife and I was like, she's beautiful. And in that moment, I just said, God, thank you so much for the gift of my wife. Now, that was in my heart. That was what's going on. But here's what I had to do. I had to rise above the noise. In our culture today, there's a lot of people who have opinions. Like, I'm in the dressing room at the gym the other day, and all of a sudden, all the men in that dressing room are expert baseball managers. They have this figured out, how the Blue Jays can come back. And in the changing room, they're talking about why John Gibbons is such a horrible manager. And I'm going, nobody talked about John Gibbons back in June and July. But all of a sudden, everybody has an opinion, right? So we live in this culture. Now, in society, let's just go there because Jesus is going there. Marriage is just being totally thrown out the window. I'll just be up front. We have a society that wants to give a new definition to marriage, and I'm going, God has already given the definition of marriage. In fact, God's the one who has created marriage. So it doesn't really matter what society says marriage is. It matters what does God say marriage is. So people in our world today have this negative view of marriage, and at the same time, the church, we sort of blow it up. Here's what I mean. You've probably heard messages on marriage, and the preacher will stand up and he'll say things like this. Even in the church, over 50% of marriages end in divorce. We're no different than the world. So I'm here to sort of haul us back in because sometimes statistics and everything else gets all crazy, and pretty soon we're looking at and we're going, marriage is a mess, where's God, oh no. But I want to reassure you today that we have a God who's good, a God who's in control, and a God who's at work. So just some statistics here. We're living in a time where people have a very low view of marriage. We do. We have people who say things like this, even in the church. Well, we don't need to legally get married. We're married in our hearts. And I go, that's not biblical. You're not married in your hearts. We live in a world that goes, it's just a piece of paper. What's the big deal? I can still love her. I can still love him. And we can live together. And we have people who are like, they're like my husband and wife, but they haven't sealed the deal. They haven't got married or committed, but they refer to each other as their wife and husband. This is a very low view of marriage. Now, they say over 50% of marriages end, even in the church, but I'm here to tell you, basically, that only 30% of marriages end in our world today. 30%. That's the statistic. It's not 50. It's 30%. Now, get this. Among those 30%, the ones who divorce are the ones who marry before the age of 20. They live together, and maybe they had a baby together. They are a huge part of that 30% statistic of marriages divorcing. Surveys tell us that the number of married people who say they're very happy in their marriages is high. 61 to 62% of people go, I'm happy in my marriage. So here's what I want to do. I want to refocus us, because what the world is looking at when it comes to marriages, it's so horrible, you probably don't want to go there and do it. But I'm here to say 61 to 62% of people say, I'm happy in my marriage. Good news? That's good news in our world today. According to Harvard-trained researcher Shante Feldhen, she says this, the rate of divorce in the church is 25 to 50% lower than among those who don't attend worship services, and those who prioritize their faith and pray together are dramatically happy and more connected. And I go, well, go figure. So it's actually good news. This is really good news. I just don't want to throw the stats at you, but I share this because maybe you're here and you're single today, or maybe you're here and you're married and you believe the false assumptions that over 50% are heading to divorce, that people are very unhappy in their marriage. I share this because it's easy to live in fear. It's easy to go, if you're single, well, I don't want to get married. If over 50% divorce, why? And I'm here to say that's not real. That's a blowing up statistic. I don't want you to be a Debbie Downer about marriage, since you're assuming that it might head for destruction. So here's what I want to do. Jesus loves marriage. By the way, Jesus was a single guy. Jesus points us back to the true identity of marriage. And I know fear comes to many of us, and many times I'll say this, marriage is actually just really hard work, and sometimes we've heard it said that, well, marriage is 50-50. The reality is marriage is 100-100. That means the husband gives 100% and the wife gives 100%. So marriage isn't give or take, it's all in. It's hard work. Hard work might scare some people, but here's the good news. Just because it's hard work doesn't mean that it's always hard, all right? So we want to work in our marriages. At the same time, I know some marriages are struggling, so I don't want to downplay the deep pain that comes out of that. Some of you are feeling that this is just an unsolvable maze, what I'm in my marriage. So today I want to bring you hope. I want to bring you encouragement. Maybe some of us have given up on our marriages, but if we're honest, we didn't think we'd put the ticket in so fast to get out of it. So if you're here and you're married and you're going, I don't want to be married, I'm here to give you hope today. Hope that it's totally worth working towards saving your marriage. Maybe you're single and you have so many fears about marriage, while at the same time you're wondering, does God even have marriage in the works for me? Maybe you're a child of divorce, or you have close loved ones who have divorced, or you're close to divorcing. Maybe you're here and you're doing well. You're happy. You're in that married state and things are good. And maybe you're single and you're fine. You're satisfied there and you're just ready to tune me out today. I want to say, come back to God's word with me. Jesus has some amazing things to say. And again, if you're visiting today, it just so happened you showed up when we're preaching on Mark 10 on divorce and remarriage. We're not out to get you, okay? We've been preaching through the book of Mark for over a year. Took a little break to go through Galatians. This is just the next section, verse by verse, through the gospel of Mark. And here's what we're doing. We're rediscovering Jesus. We're going, who was Jesus? What was Jesus about? What did Jesus teach? So the first point today is this, the hardened heart of man against God. Mark 10 verses 1 to 5, I read it at the start of the marriage, but we're going to touch on those verses, and we're going to see where we go. There's a lot here. For those of you who don't know, we do have a church in Charlottetown that meets tonight, and the majority of people who go to Charlottetown are young adults, and they're single. So I'm not going to go to town tonight to preach a marriage just on marriage and divorce when I have a bunch of young 18 to 25-year-olds who are wondering, What does God have in store? So I want to address singles. I want to address married people today. I want to address even if you've experienced divorce. And I want to address even very quickly at the end, children, because they are a blessing. But what did Jesus mean when he brings in children? So here's what's happening. Jesus is leaving Capernaum. At this point, he's moving now to Jerusalem. He's going to Calvary. He's going to die on a cross very soon. So he's on this journey towards Jerusalem. This is the region of Herod Antipas. And if you remember so far in Mark, John the Baptist called out this ruler. Called him out. And for calling him out, John the Baptist was put in prison. And then his final ending was he was beheaded. So this is where Jesus is now. He's in that region where John the Baptist gave his life. He was a martyr. Lo and behold, as usual, whenever Jesus does some public teaching, here comes the Pharisees. So the Pharisees are the religious rulers of the day. They don't like what Jesus is saying. So whenever Jesus teaches, some Pharisees show up. Now notice, Mark tells us their motive. The Pharisees are there to test Jesus. They didn't come because they go, Jesus is such a great teacher. They came because they're like, how do we test him? Basically, their question's not sincere. When they ask Jesus about divorce, they want to trap him. That's their goal. They want to put Jesus in the hot seat. So the Pharisees were not genuinely inquiring of Jesus' position. They want to test him to make him look bad. That's all they want to do. They want to give Jesus the hard question so that he has to answer it, and that will make him look bad. Now, here's what you need to know. Everybody in Judaism agreed that divorce was permissible. So everyone believed it, that it was permissible. You can read all the same scholarly stuff, commentaries I've been reading. You can read all of those, and you can see that the people in Jesus' day, we're on all sides of the divorce issue. All sides. So today, even in the church, we have divorce, and we have people, guess what? On all sides. So today is no different than Jesus' day. The Pharisees are trying to trap Jesus. The Pharisees allowed for divorce, and we'll see in a moment, probably for a lot of reasons, okay? Probably for a lot of reasons. But they have a suspicion that Jesus is probably going to be a little stricter when it comes to divorce. Maybe they heard his teaching, Matthew chapter 5, on the famous Sermon on the Mount. Maybe they heard some of what Jesus said when it came to that. Because the Pharisees are very sneaky because of Herod. They're in Herod's territory. And guess what? A little history about Herod. He was married, but he started to fall in love with his half-niece Herodias, who was married to his half-brother. So this is like a Jerry Springer episode. This is daytime TV in real life. So Herod divorces his wife. Herodias divorces her husband. And guess what happens? Herod and Herodias marry. John the Baptist shows up and starts calling them out. He gets beheaded. So here's Jesus in the region where Herod was called out for his sin, and the Pharisees are showing up because they have one motive. We're going to trap Jesus, because if he says divorce is okay, we'll be all over that. And if he doesn't say it's okay, Herod will probably come for Jesus and we'll be rid of Jesus. So they have these impure motives. So there's all kinds of messed up going up in here. Are you with me? Like, this is messed up. Marrying your half-niece, getting divorced, remarrying. So Herod is living in this mess. So the Pharisees are hoping that Jesus would get beheaded. So they ask this question. Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife? There's parallel accounts to this. Matthew chapter 9, and in the book of Luke, there's another account. But in Matthew 19, that question, there's something added in. So Matthew 19, verse 3, the question was, for every cause, is it lawful for a man to divorce a wife? They say, okay, Jesus, let's just talk about what we can't do. That's what the Pharisees want to do. Let's talk about what we can't do. By the way, church, this is Satan in the Garden of Eden, Genesis chapter 3. Don't look at all of God's provisions for you. Let's just take it back and let's magnify God's boundaries that God has set himself and what he doesn't allow, because God doesn't want you to be happy. God's just a grumpy old man. That's basically what Satan has said. That's here what the Pharisees are saying. So let's talk about marriage. But here's the thing. God has set up boundaries. So instead of looking at how gracious and how good and how blessed we are because of God, they go, let's look at the boundaries God sets. And they want to focus on that. They want to focus. So here's what we see. Divorce is permitted and practiced freely by the Jews, including the leaders. But the grounds on which they can divorce is debated. So the grounds on which a divorce can take place is debated. So what are they arguing about? Deuteronomy chapter 24, verses 1 to 4. The verses are going to come up on the screen, and this is what we read. When a man takes a wife and marries her, if then she finds no favor in his eyes, because he has found some indecency in her, and he writes her a certificate of divorce, he puts it in her hand and sends her out of his house, and she departs out of his house. And if she goes and becomes another man's wife, and the latter man hates her and writes her a certificate of divorce and puts it in her hand and sends her out of his house, or if the latter man dies, who took her to be his wife? Verse 4, then her former husband who sent her away may not take her again to be his wife after she has been defiled, for that is an abomination before the Lord. And you shall not bring sin upon the land that the Lord your God is giving you for inheritance. Now Moses writes this in the Old Testament, the Pentateuch, the first five books. And here's what they're debating over. There's a phrase in there that says, some indecency. So the Jews of the time, the scribes of the time, would get together and they would always debate, what does some indecency mean? It's a very ambiguous phrase. And the Jews, they argued about it all the time. So there's two camps of thought on that phrase. The first one is the more conservative school, and this group said indecency means adultery. So the more conservative goes, that's what indecency means. But the liberal school of thought and the group said this, for any reason, unload that woman. That's their view. Conservatives, adultery, liberals, more saying whatever the reason, it's okay, just get rid of her. So things like, maybe she burnt your dinner, divorce her. Maybe she's made a negative comment about your mom, divorce her. Maybe she doesn't like what you're wearing, divorce her. That's where the liberal thought of the day was going. So let's guess which view everyone preferred. It's the liberal view. Everyone preferred the liberal view. They surely knew that Jesus was against divorce. So to get Jesus to say that again in Herod's territory is to get the crowd in that territory to go against him. So how will Jesus answer? That's the question. How is he going to answer? And here's what Jesus does. Because he's an amazing teacher, he just asks him a question right back. What did Moses command you? In other words, forget Rabbi so-and-so. What does Moses say? He discards their tradition. He discards every rabbi who ever weighed in on the subject. And here's what I love about Jesus. He just goes back to Scripture. So what does the Scripture say? Not what does Rabbi so-and-so say, but what does the Scripture say? So they summarize Deuteronomy chapter 24, verses 1 to 4. And if you notice all the verbs in the opening exchange, Jesus asks about commands, but they reply in terms of permission. Jesus says, what's commanded? And they're saying, what's permitted? So they're off focus. They're not going back to what's the original plan. David Garland explains the reason this way. Because in Deuteronomy 24, here's what we got to see. It does not encourage divorce, but it gives a regulation for what to do after it happens. In other words, Deuteronomy 24, divorce is tolerated, it's permitted, but it's not authorized, it's not sanctioned. So, church, divorce, we need to see this right off the top, is never God's design. Okay? Never God's design. So David Garland says this, the legislation on divorce certificates protected wives from brutal abandonment. It freed a wife from the accusation of adultery when out of necessity remarried. It prevented the first husband from destroying her new marriage by trying to reclaim her. It deterred anything that might look like wife swapping. That's what Garland says on this topic. So the heart of the passage is basically, you need to see this, God's design is this, but when sin messes it up, here's the actions. Here's what takes place. The Pharisees want to talk about what's acceptable, what's the reasons for a divorce. Jesus wants to talk about the sanctity of marriage. You need to see the difference here. They want to talk about when a marriage can be broken. Jesus wants to talk about why marriages shouldn't be broken. It reminds me of when we ask things like this. Where's the line? Well, how far is too far? How much is too much? So here's what Jesus does. He talks about the hardness of people's hearts. That's where Jesus is going. And as the reason, that's the reason for the commandment. Do you know why we have commands in Scripture about divorce? It's because the human heart is hard, and now God, with his law, has to control the sinfulness that will take place. That's Deuteronomy 24. That's why it was there in the Scriptures. Basically, due to the fall, we now have to come up with safeguards to limit sinfulness because of the fall, because of the brokenness. So what's Jesus saying? What's he getting at? And here's what he's getting at. In the kingdom, the question isn't when divorce is permissible. So if you know Christ and you're married and you're following Jesus, the question isn't when is divorce permissible? That's not the question. The kingdom question is this. How can we live into the story of God's design for marriage? So if you follow Jesus and you're married, your question is, how do we live for the glory of Jesus in our marriage as husband and wife? Not what's permissible. We see the original intention here of lifelong commitment, intimacy, basically that the whole lives of husband, of wife, are intertwined with each other. That's the beauty of marriage. In his kingdom, Jesus says, the question is not when we're allowed to divorce, but how we can live into this story instead of the world story. Because we live in a world today that just goes, if you want a divorce, just go get a divorce. But God's story is this, fight for your marriage, work for your marriage, honor me in your marriage, not don't go that way. That's basically God's declarations from Scripture. In a group this big, there's going to be some who have experienced maybe divorce in their life. If not, you've been affected by it some way. Maybe you're a child of divorce. So Jesus and others in Scripture deal with the questions of how to handle this. So we're going to see in a moment, so hear me again, there's hope. There's hope. even to those of us who might have failed. There's hope. There's always hope with Jesus. Guilt and shame that might come to you. Maybe you're here today and you're divorced, and here's what Satan wants to do. He wants to fill you with guilt. He wants to fill you with shame, but that's not of God. So don't fall for the lie. And at the same time, the Holy Spirit maybe wants to confront, convict. That's actually healthy. So maybe the Spirit of God will convict you in this area today, and I just encourage you, obey the Spirit of God. Run to the Spirit of God. See, in the kingdom story, failure won't be assumed. So when I do weddings for a young couple, I'm not standing there going, oh, I'll give them 7 years. No, that's not assumed in the kingdom. When we come together and we celebrate a Christian marriage, we're going, this is amazing. This is a lifelong commitment. In fact, I want to be there for them. I want to be an encouragement for them. I've been married for many years. I know the hardships. I know the pain. I want to come alongside of that couple, and I want to say to them, don't quit. Don't give up. Keep going. Keep pursuing. I've been where you are. I know it's so tempting to want to run out, but don't. So in the kingdom, we don't assume marriages are failing. We actually celebrate them, and we believe they're going to what? Persevere to the end. Why? Because we have Jesus. Jesus is the center. Jesus is the hope. Here's what's so beautiful. When we look at marriage, Eve, Genesis chapter 1, Adam's all in the garden by himself. And I'm like, God, like, couldn't you put him in a football field? He's in a garden. But he's in the garden, and he's naming all the animals, and he's you know, just living there. Like, this is man cave to the max. And in Genesis chapter 1, 22, he gets Eve. She's a gift of grace. Adam didn't ask for her. He didn't give God any lists. You need to see this. He didn't say, "Here, hey God, I'm looking for a woman like this. Here's my list." Adam didn't do that. God brings him Eve, and here's what he does. The dude busts out like Marvin Gaye. That's what he does. Eve shows up, and he's like, "Let's get it on," right? Are you with me? That's what he does. He writes the first poetry in the Bible. He writes the first song in the Bible when Eve shows up. It's actually beautiful. And here's what you need to know about Adam. Adam didn't know what he needed until God brought Eve. He had no clue. There's some single man going, oh, I know what I need. No, you have no clue. You don't know what you need. God does. And if you obey and you walk with God, he takes care of everything. So here's what Adam does. He celebrates God's gift to him, but the moment sin enters, God confronts Adam, and what does he say? What does Adam say to God? Here's what he says. Genesis 3:12. It was the woman you gave to me. Do you know what Adam just did? God, I was fine. I was hanging out with the animals. I was like Tarzan. And it's your fault because you brought Jane. You brought Eve. You brought this woman into my life. And now our marriage is in big trouble. That's what Adam's saying to God. Now, forget the joy. Forget the grace. Forget everything. God's great gift is thrown back into his face. So Adam takes it, crumbles it up, and throws it back at God and says, that's on you. You did this. The woman you gave me. So not only is it the woman's fault, God, it's your fault. That's what Adam does. It was his hard-heartedness against God. It's a heart that's ungrateful. It's a heart that shifts blame on God. Center point. If we want to see God moving in our marriages, here's what we got to do. We must own up to our own sinfulness. Here's what's so easy in marriage. Well, if he would just fix himself, this would be so much better. Well, if she would just fix what she's doing, this would be so much better. And instead of owning our own sinfulness, we point out others' faults. Now, thankfully, God redeems Adam and Eve's marriage. They're intimate again. Genesis chapter 4, they end up, you need to see this. Sometimes we skip over this, but Adam and Eve went through a lot of brokenness, church. They have two sons, Cain and Abel. Cain murders his brother, so Adam and Eve lose their son. Not only that, Cain is now banished, so they lose what? Their other son. This is a lot of brokenness. This is hard on a marriage, but you need to see this. God, in his grace, as they walk with him and they persevere with him, gives them their son, Seth. So even in that, you need to see, even in the pain, in the grief, God is still good. God's grace even overcomes even the worst of situations and the worst heart hardness. His grace always can overcome it. So there's a lot of hope, right? A lot of hope. But instead of focusing on reasons for why we should divorce, Jesus now flips the conversation to talk about, hey, here's why God is for marriage. Let me tell you why God is for marriage. So I want to be like Christ today, and instead of really diving in to divorce, we'll touch on it, but I want to go back to marriage. Jesus goes there, so I'm just going to follow Jesus' lead. If you got any complaints with that, talk to God. Point number two, God's heart for marriage, verses 6 to 12. So if all you hear are the reasons a marriage covenant might be broken, I'll tell you this. That's like learning to fly, but when you learn to fly, you practice crash landings first, right? So you go for flying lessons, and you're like, can I just learn how to crash the plane? That's not wise. So when you go for flying lessons, you go to fly, learn to fly. So instead of talking about what to do when the plane crashes, here's what Jesus does. He decides to talk about the joys of flying the plane. Isn't marriage joyful? Like, who's flowing? Who? Come on. Yeah, a few. Right? So takeoff comes. If you're like me, I got a wad of gum in my mouth because I can't fly unless I'm chewing gum because my ears kill. So I'm there. I'm like, oh, man. And then, right, it's a big wad. I'm like, flying so fun. No, I'm not by the window. I'm by the aisle. I'm like, let's get this over. So we start takeoff, and it's crazy, right? Like, you're going up. It's absolutely amazing. We're actually flying in the air. And people complain all the time. Like, my aisle's so small. I got no leg room. You're in the air. You're flying. So you're flying, right? And then all of a sudden, maybe the pilot, he comes on over the intercom and he says this, put on your seatbelts. It's probably going to be a little rough. Ever hit those patches? It's like, you're like, oh no, the movie's coming true. The roof's going to rip off, we're dead, it's over, and you're holding on to your seat, and then you land, and you're like, wow, we got here. Like, I flew from Charlottetown all the way to Vancouver. That's absolutely amazing, right? So the joys of flying. How about marriage? You get married at the start, it's like, this is amazing. Year one, you're like, who is that person? Ever been there? Yeah, there you go. So then all of a sudden it's like, oh, they brought me flowers. They're so sweet. They're so romantic. And then, you know, the next anniversary, you're like, hello. And they're like, what? Do you know what day it is? Tuesday. No, it's our anniversary. And then that's a big fun ride. Who hasn't forgotten a birthday? Who hasn't forgotten an anniversary? The only ones who haven't are the ones who call the flower shop and say, on this date, every day till I die, please send flowers. They're the only ones I know of. And it's like, honey, thanks for the flowers. And he's like, what? Oh, yeah, it's your birthday. That's a smart man, right? Smart. So here's what God does. Instead of talking about, here's the reasons why to divorce, Jesus says this. We should be asking, what's God's original design for marriage? What's his original design? So Genesis 1:27, God creates man in his own image. It says in verse 28 and chapter 1, 27, 28, that God creates them in his own image. He makes them male and female, and then he gives them this command, be fruitful and multiply. Tim Keller says this, but obviously this wonderful gift of creating new human life is something we can only carry out together. Neither sex has all the characteristics necessary. Only in a complementary union can we do it. These verses suggest strongly that the sexes, while equal in dignity and worth, are complementary. They work together, husband and wife. Both are equally made in God's image. Both are equally blessed. Both are equally given dominion over the earth. But here's what they do. They have to work it like a ballroom dance. Now, again, I can't dance. One of the first times I danced was at our vow renewal this June. That was probably it. Other than that, it was when I asked Kelsey to marry me. Other than that, I don't dance. But if you can picture this, working together, it's like a ballroom dance. One leads, the other follows. Do you remember church? Adam sings. He sang this. This at last is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. I don't know how he sang that, but he sang it. And Eve just went, oh, that's amazing. That's beautiful. So what's Adam saying when he says that? Is he saying, I love you, baby cakes? No. Do you know what he's saying? He's saying this. I am you. I am you. This is huge. Finally, he's saying, I feel like myself. He's saying to Eve, you bring out in me and you make up what's lacking in me. But once sin entered, this was broken. So the reign of co-equals, once sin enters, it's over. So the relationship now becomes a fierce dispute with each party trying to rule the other. And I say, hello, marriage. That's where we're at. So here's what happens. The ballroom dance becomes a boxing match. So let's get out of the box. Let's get out of the ballroom. Let's go to the ring. This is marriage. Real? Oh, yeah. We're always trying to get the upper hand in marriage. That's how it's going in our culture today. Now, God in his sovereignty, in his redemptive purposes in Christ, you need to see this. He gave you this gift in your sinful spouse. Your spouse is not your enemy, but he's God's great provision for you, or she's God's great provision for you. So your spouse is never your enemy, okay? I've been married for 10 years now, just over 10, and I'm realizing this. Marriage just brings out a confrontation with yourself. That's what it does. Marriage does this all the time. There's times in my marriage when I thought, well, Kelsey, she just needs to get her act together, when God is actually pointing out to me, Howie, you need to get your act together. Marriage is a giant mirror, and it shows you the real you, and it's looking back, and it's like you're looking right at yourself. God, in his kindness, shows us these things, church, through our spouse. It's what's so beautiful. God's so good to us to show us where we fail, where we mess up, and we see it many times in our spouse. Now, I'll say this. I'm running out of time, and there's so much to say. Marriage, your spouse must be a secondary source of joy, source of fulfillment. So if you're here and you know Jesus, he's your joy. He's your source of fulfillment. Marriage, it's beautiful, but Jesus is more beautiful. So don't look to your spouse as your savior. Don't go, well, if only they did this for me, I would be so much happier. I would be so much better off. No, you're already better off with Jesus. Spouses, husbands, wives make lousy saviors. And if you show up and you bring those expectations into marriage, thinking that this man or this woman is going to complete me, that they're going to bring me pure joy that's so perfect. You're showing up to the wrong place. Those expectations can't be carried into marriage. It's not like you got Savage Garden songs on cassette tapes labeled mixed love songs. Some of you have no clue who Savage Garden is. But going through high school, that's what I did. I went to the radio, I put in a cassette tape, and I taped love songs. Because, man, I was looking, and I was on the hunt, and I'm going to get a girl. And the best way to get a girl, give her a mixtape. We were stupid. And I'm not the only guy who did that. All of the guys showed up with their mixtapes and then go to the girl and say, hey, when you go home tonight, you should listen to that. And it had songs like this. Savage Garden, I think I dreamed you into life. Like, this is crazy. I knew I loved you before I met you. I've been waiting all of my life. There's just no rhyme or reason, only this sense of completion. And in your eyes, I see the missing pieces. Like, this is beautiful, right? I'm searching for it. I think I found my way home. I know it might sound more than a little crazy. Oh, yeah, it does. But I believe 1,000 angels dance around you. I'm complete now that I found you. And I'm like, who are we singing about? Jesus? No, this song is directed to a girl, to a boy. And as you sat on the bus, you were like, I'll find him. I'll find her. I'll hunt her down. She'll be mine. Center point, if you show up to your marriage in picture it this way, with a ghetto blaster on your shoulder, blasting out those tunes, you complete me, you're perfect, look out, you're going to hit marriage, and it's going to hit you like that. And you're going to go, they're not so amazing. They're not so perfect. And what husband hasn't heard this from their wife? You know, when we were engaged, man, you really pursued me. Why don't you do stuff like that anymore? Do you know why? Because men think we've already hunted and we've captured. I got you. And at the altar, I said, I love you, and that should be good. That's how men think. And women are like, don't you love me? Because if you love me, you would hunt for me every day. The joys of marriage. That's what it is, the joys of marriage. So here's where I'll go. Marriage is a priority in God's design. So get this, you leave your dad, you leave your mom, and you cling to your wife. That's your family. I'm not saying forget your parents. I'm saying you don't forsake them. But here's the thing, you're now in a new family. It's you and your husband. It's you and your wife. It's you and your wife. And if you have kids, you got the kids. Family, secondary to this. Sometimes in marriage, what we do is we bring in all the moms and dads, and everybody's got an opinion. No, it's the husband and the wife. Here's what I love about the garden. It was the husband and the wife, not the parent and the children. It was what? Husband and wife. Marriage is a priority. The best thing, if you're here and you have kids, the best thing a kid needs is a good marriage. That's the best thing they need. A good marriage. Mom and dad, they love Jesus. Mom and dad, they're not perfect. They mess up, but they serve Jesus. And the kids see that. And the kids go, this isn't just the church thing. This is their life. They love Jesus. They love each other. And that speaks more than a preacher on Sunday morning, church. You going home and loving your spouse, that speaks volumes. That is love in action. Marriage also has power. 2, becoming 1 shows us that marriage has the power to set the course of your life as a whole. Here's what's so awesome. Someone on the street could go, hey, Howie, your hair is horrible. And I could go, no, it's not. It's amazing. Do you know why? Because I left my house and my wife said, Howie, your hair is amazing. You look great. And I don't care what anyone else says. Because you know why? My wife thinks I'm awesome. And I walk that street and I'm like, this is good. This is good. Husbands, tell your wife, you're beautiful. You look great today. Speak those words. Because marriage has power. Fourth thing, marriage is to be permanent. Now, I'll just touch on this very quickly because this is where Jesus goes into divorce. But again, I want to point you back to Matthew. Now, all sorts of smart people, smarter than myself, would disagree with me when it comes to divorce and remarriage. But at the same time, all sorts of smart people, scholars, would also agree with me. So some people go, all divorce is sinful. I want to say this. Divorce happens because of sin, but not all divorce is sinful. Jesus in Matthew 19 points out to really one area. He points out adultery, and he basically says this. That could cause divorce. That could cause the partner from leaving the marriage, and I believe this is the exception. They're free to remarry. In 1 Corinthians chapter 7, it talks about a believing spouse with a non-believing spouse. And Paul says this, stay at your marriage. Love them. Love them like Christ. But if that non-believing spouse abandons you, if he leaves the marriage, you're free to remarry. However, it's always reconciliation. It's always reconciliation. So I believe those are some of the causes. Now, we don't have the time to dive in, and I want to say we want to treat marriage and divorce with gentleness, kindness, and love in the church. So what looks like abandonment today in our day and age? Well, that would be, have to be handled with delicate hands in a way. Here's what I want to tell you. Divorce is not the unforgivable sin. Church, we should never look down on people who are divorced. Never. So if you're here and you're committed, you've been married, we never look at people who have been divorced and go, no. We don't. We don't do that. Do you know what the only unforgivable sin is? So what the Bible says, blaspheming against the Holy Spirit, which simply means this. If you don't get your sin right with Jesus, you can't be forgiven. You might die and you'll go to heaven, but if you have not dealt with your sin now, you cannot be with Jesus forever. It's not possible. The only sin that cannot be forgiven is if you don't acknowledge your sinfulness. But you might sit here today, you might be divorced, you might be on a second, third marriage. I don't know you. God does. But here's what I want to tell you. Stay in the marriage you're in. Pursue Jesus. Love Jesus. Own up to your sinfulness maybe in the past. Get that right with Jesus. On the one hand, I think God might not have given us necessarily all the grounds for divorce. Paul brings one up in Corinthians. I think we got to be sensitive to some situations. I'll end with the children, verses 13 to 16. And then I'll wrap it up. Jesus brings the disciples right off into a house again. He's teaching them. Here's what you need to realize about children in Jesus' day. Children really didn't contribute much to a family. They consumed lots of resources, but they gave very little in return. 6 out of 10 children died before the age of 16 in Jesus' day. Children were seen as the least important members of society. Here's what I love about Jesus. Jesus says in Mark 10:14, "Let the little children come to me. Do not hinder them, for the kingdom of God belongs to such as these." What's his point? Here's his point. In the kingdom story, the people everyone else avoids are not only welcomed, but they're embraced. Jesus goes to children because one thing about children, they're not innocent. If you're sitting here going, "My child's so perfect and innocent," you've been deceived. Children are not innocent. That's not why Jesus says, "Become like the child." Children are dependent. Guess who they need? They need you. They're dependent. And this is what Jesus is saying. Become like children. Depend on me. That's all you got to do. I've done it all. I've taken care of you. Depend on me. We have to become like a little child in order to enter the kingdom, Jesus says. And that's helplessness. That's going, "God, I can't save myself. God, I can't get my sin right on my own." And Jesus says, "Depend on me. Depend on the cross, the power of the resurrection." Now, yesterday I was sitting at my desk and I was having a conversation with God about this passage because it was a heavy passage. And I thought, what would God say it's like to be married to Howie McMaster? I'm part of his bride. Jesus is my Savior. And I started thinking, what would God think? And I feel like Jesus would be right if he said, "Well, a lot of times you treat our relationship like it means nothing to you." So I wrote that down. "Very often, you don't want to communicate with me, and I find you in the bed of people's approval instead of my own to find your significance." You give your heart away to so many other lovers. A lot of times, you're too lazy to take care of the precious gift of your wife that I gave you. Here's what I felt God, in a way, was putting on me. "God, you have every reason to divorce me. I'm not a good spouse. I'm not faithful the way I should be." Pastor Jarrett Wilson says, "If Jesus were keeping a list of our wrongs, none of us would stand a chance at any second of any day, even on our best days. Jesus could have the legal grounds to say, 'Enough of this. I can't do it anymore. You violated my love for the last time.'" The truth is, you and I have never met a wrong spouse like Jesus. You've never met a disrespected spouse like Jesus. You never met a spouse who more than carried their weight like Jesus. Never. And you thought your marriage was bad. Center point. This is the longest bad marriage in history. Jesus' marriage to us would be like having the bride from hell. So here is the reality, and I love this. I thought, "Jesus, you have every reason to divorce me," but then all of a sudden, the Spirit of God just spoke to my heart, and I wrote this down, and the Spirit of God just spoke to me and said, "But you know something, Howie? When I left my Father's house to come to earth, I was glued to you." I went, "Whoa. You were glued to me?" Jesus is saying, "I was in this man. I was there. Sickness and in health, for better, for worse. And in fact, death can't even separate us. I came to find you. I came to make you my own. The first Adam, he blamed his wife, but I, Howie, the second Adam, took my bride's blame, shame, and guilt. And when it came time to pay the cost for this marriage gone bad, I went to the cross. I knew, Howie. I knew all that you have done, past, present, and into the future. I knew it all. In fact, I saw you denying me, abandoning me, forsaking me. I saw it all. I saw the ways that you violated this relationship. But here's the thing. There is more love in my heart than sin in yours. My love is an everlasting love. It lasts forever. So I went gladly to pay the price if it meant I would have you fall into my arms. I decided to stay in my marriage to you on the cross. So center point, I'll end with this. This relationship is ultimately one-sided. One-sided. He is carrying the whole thing on his back. He stayed. He loved you, and he will love you to the end. So husbands, you look at his love, and you hold on because of his love. Wives, you look to his love. Hold on to the single people. Soak your heart in this. Jesus loves me better than any man or any woman ever will. And just soak your heart in that. To the married couples here right now, stay in your marriage. Fight for your marriage. We need to leave the noise. We need to rise above the noise. We need to get this buzzing out of our ears that it's an easy way out. No, you stay. You fight for the glory of Jesus. So this morning, you're invited to become a little child. You're invited to come to Jesus, the one who obtained, basically, above the noise victory for you through the cross. So I just say this. Keep sitting under this fountain of love until you're drenched in it. Until you're drenched in it. Heavenly Father, I want to thank you today for your love, for your grace, for your mercy, for your compassion. And God, I pray, if there's anyone sitting in this room today who has not experienced the love of Jesus, I pray, God, that today you would encounter them in a fresh way, that you would change their life forever, God. God, I pray, if there's anyone sitting here going through a hard time in marriage, I pray that you would speak hope, that you would speak power into their marriage. I pray, God, if there's singles here who are just going, what's the point of getting married? I pray that you would rebuke that you would challenge that, and that they would see your beautiful design for marriage, and that they would honor you. And I pray for the young people coming up, that they would love Jesus, that they would love their spouse, and they would pursue Jesus together, and that you would raise up families who love Jesus, families who love the gospel, families who live that out so that a dark world can see there is a change, there is a difference. We need Jesus. We need to run to Jesus. I pray for the divorcee who might be sitting here. I pray if they feel any guilt or shame, you would knock that away and you would replace it with your love, with your grace. And God, I pray hope into their life, hope into their situation, because I know you're good. I know you want to work for their good. So do your work. We love you, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen. Thank you.